Africa is a land rich with extraordinary history and is land that has been blessed by nature. From the pyramids of the pharaohs to the kraal of Shaka Zulu, the Zenj Empire of East Africa to the Fulani land of West Africa, our motherland is indeed blessed. However, with great gifts also come great responsibilities. Africa has constantly suffered from many shocks in the communities, both man-made and natural calamities. Conflict in the DRC, HIV and AIDS in South Africa, urban development in Ghana and other cities, floods in Uganda, Mozambique, and many other parts of the continent that have been affected in various ways. In Uganda, it has been a rather sad story, with mountainous and hilly regions facing experiences of devastating landslides, floods, and wars. Areas that lie in the valleys, like the Teso region that includes Katakwi and Soroti, that is sandwiched between the Mount Elgon and Mount Moroto. Areas in the Mount Rwenzori ranges, like Ntoroko district, Kasese, and Fort Portal, are prone to these disasters. Worst of all is the fact that it is only when death occurs that these calamities come to light. Very fresh on the minds of Ugandans are the landslides in Bududa that is said to have claimed hundreds of lives and displaced thousands of people. More disheartening here is the fact that these landslides happen every year but rarely get the deserved attention. In other words, it becomes a problem of the people. They are forced to live with the burden and only hope it does not leave behind drastic effects. The rainy season of May to June 2013 has caused floods in Kasese, Ntoroko, Teso region and parts of Kampala like Mwaise. The most floods with the most devastating effects hit Kasese district. Kasese is a district located in western Uganda and surrounded by Mount Rwenzori ranges. It is also home to the historically famous Kilembe mines, which for many years was one of the biggest sites for copper mining. Hima Cement Factory, arguably one of the very biggest cement producing companies in Uganda, and many other tourist attractions like Queen Elizabeth National Park. The majority of inhabitants of Kasese practice farming, both livestock and crop production. It was Wednesday, the 1st of May 2013, at around 10 a.m., when what seemed like a normal downpour of rain suddenly resulted into a ferocious flood of heavy water streaming down from the mountains through River Nyamwamba. The water, with so much force, carried rocks and huge stones from the mountains that swept away anything along its path. So powerful it was that it could not be contained in the normal river channels, thus creating its own new channels, leaving behind massive destruction.
It was Thursday, Friday. I was down there in my chamber. When I reached here, I met a very, very much water coming from up. Then almost covered the road. And that water was carrying trees, stones. I can't explain.
It's unfortunate on 1st May, we experienced very destructive floods caused by so many rivers, mainly the river Nyamwamba, that flows through the Kilembe and Lake George. In Maliva, there is the river Muvuku, which is known mostly for power generation, the water that is for power generation. It has the KCCL power generation, it has Tronda power, it has Kilembe Mines power generation. And other rivers, small rivers that flow into those main rivers. Nicharumba, Nyamgasani River was a disaster. It has caused also a lot of damage.
What the diversion of the river began from here. This is where the diversion began from. It broke the bridge, then it diverted here. This is a school.
Primary school.
As you can see, this school survived because it has a very firm foundation. Quite firm. But it went directly here, and the toilets survived because they were also made of cement, and that's when it now continued downstream. So this is where the diversion of the water, actually, the river, took place.
The road network has been greatly damaged and some roads closed or rendered impassable. Alternative routes had to be either created or traffic diverted through alternative, longer routes. For example, heavy trucks had to go through Mbarara. This, of course, resulted into inflation of commodity prices. As many as 19 bridges were swept away or badly damaged.
Kasese, Charumba is not accessible because the bridge has collapsed in between near Dunguruha, on Dunguruha River. The main bridge on River Nyamgasani within Charumba town that connects Kagando Hospital is also broken, and that one is a very big one. It can take about 1 billion to be repaired.
Some bridges have been totally washed away and others have half collapsed. And this is one of the ones that have been totally washed away, with no trace that there was a bridge at all.
Kilembe Mines Hospital, a referral hospital in Kasese, was left in ruins. 78 patients were evacuated to numerous health centers like St. Paul's Health Center 4, Kasese Municipal Center 3, Kagando Hospital, Bwera Hospital, and as far away as Fort Portal Regional Referral Hospital. Equipment suffered severe damage, drugs and supplies were lost, and the sewerage system was totally damaged.
But then at around 11 a.m., the water increased. And when it increased, we started notifying the patients to leave the wards and go outside. And God helped us, we managed to get all the patients out, so we did not lose any life. The water even entered the hospital, in the wards, in the store, so everything was destroyed, in fact. Most of the equipments were covered by sand. The drugs we lost in theater. The patients even went with blankets and bed sheets. It's almost there. The hospital, as I talk, we don't have anything in the hospital. And at the moment, even we have closed the hospital, and we don't know when we shall reopen the hospital.
As many as 381 homes were destroyed. In Kilembe Mines Hospital alone, 17 staff quarters, all of which were permanent structures, were swept away, leaving behind 84 homeless staff, majority of whom are nurses.
Yeah, when it increased, most of the people, they had to go to the mountains because they were also scared. Yeah. The water came and swept all the staff houses. They all went.
Kasese Municipality is located in a valley, and valleys were most affected by sand and silt. The locals have taken advantage of the situation and turned to sand mining business for survival, despite the fact that returns are very little due to the cheap prices. Before the floods, a trip of sand cost 35,000 Uganda shillings, but after the flood, the same trip costs as low as 10,000 Uganda shillings. The sand has also been a major cause for hygienic threats, as it filled up toilets, houses, and compounds.
This is what the people are saying. They're still entering into the houses. So this is a cement house, and a house built with cement, and it survived. But then the silt which is in, and the property which was lost.
Generally, a total of 817 latrines and one sewerage treatment unit were completely destroyed. In some villages like Umoja, almost all toilets were either filled up or washed away. Residents of Kilembe and Kasese district usually use piped water or water from the river for domestic use. When the floods hit, two piped water supply systems for Kilembe Mines and Kasese Municipality were also destroyed. This has greatly affected the water supply situation in the municipality, and the entire population is depending on rainwater harvesting and streams. Electricity supply was completely cut off. This affected the water treatment plant in Kilembe Mines that supplies the district and surrounding areas. Previously, copper was mined from below the water table. When mining was suspended, basic maintenance services continued. For example, water purification that addressed pollution. However, with the lack of electricity supply, the polluted water is now flowing straight into the river, where it is being consumed by the locals. Acres of crops were washed away by either the water or the stones and sand, and yet this is one of the major sources of livelihood. In some areas, the whole soil was even washed away. Schools like Kilembe Primary School, Bulembia Primary School, Kilembe Senior Secondary School, and Road Barrier Primary School were damaged. Some of the schools need to be relocated before children begin their second term next month, which is within weeks. It is estimated that 7,000 people were displaced after the floods rendered them homeless. The government improvised three temporary camps using primary school facilities. However, the school term opens soon, and it's not clear where the people will be relocated.
The river was coming in a big size. We are just scattering
And the Red Cross comes with the car and said that, please, if you don't have somewhere to go, you just enter the car and we reach it here. The rain takes away with all my things. I'm just here as I am. I don't have even where to stay. So please, you help us and you give us where to stay. We are men. I'm not the only one, but we are men. I have 4 kids plus me 5 people in my family. We are 5.
Okay. Property with an estimate worth of 8 billion shillings has been lost.
This is one of the houses, if you can see along this whole line. These houses which survived were in the middle of the course of the river, the new course of the river. And the river started from the normal course of the river. The normal course of the river is that side. But then it diverted and came. So where I'm standing right now, and all these stones, there used to be houses and there used to be compounds of people. Just in front there, there was a supermarket, and the owner of the supermarket was told to evacuate by the UPDF, and he refused. He said he can't leave his very good supermarket. It had a lot of money and a lot of produce, and he hoped not that his house would survive. Unfortunately, the water swept his whole house, and he died in the floods. But there are these houses which survived, and if you can see the characteristic of all these houses are the columns which are holding the houses from down. Those are the houses which survived. So this could be one of the solutions for the people in such areas, to have strong columns holding the house, and then to leave some space for water to move through.
The government of Uganda has intervened in the situation. Through the office of the Prime Minister, the government has made a timely response to the affected.
But not 100%. So we must look for a place which is relatively safe, and the local leaders have that business. To locate that place, then we will flag them to set up a camp. With all the implications, we are prepared so long as we can save lives. I'm representing the whole government. All my colleagues are going to come here. If not, they will come here through services. I'm going to communicate to them. I'm in touch with the Minister of Health. I am in touch with the Minister of Works. It's only the Minister of Energy I have not talked to this morning, but I'm going to talk to them. So it is not just me, it is the whole government. The hospital, this building is going on already. We are again promising that we'll go and send bigger teams to do. My prayer is that in the next few days, we must have some normalcy. Probably would have lost equipment. Then the thinking is, how can we make some basic interventions to start operating in the hospital? So that to me is extremely critical. So diverting water back to where it is supposed to be is urgent, because there are more rains threatening to fall from the mountains. And this calls on all of us. And I hope now with the presence of General Keta, who will be staying here, working with the local teams, this should be done. And so that in the next few days, we come back to do interventions that are to do with the medium-term interventions to address this challenge. But this is extremely fundamental.
However, when talking of food and non-food items, directly under Prime Minister's office, we have posho bins, blankets, saucepans. We provide emission plates, mosquito nets, some clothing, and overall mobilization of other non-food items that are relevant for managing the displaced communities.
The government has distributed food and non-food items. It is important to note that without the help of the Uganda People's Defense Forces, UPDF, many more fatalities would have been registered. The UPDF evacuated people from the affected areas. They built alternative roads and created new routes, as well as mitigated or enforced damage control to prevent further damage on the bridges and roads. They also cleaned up Kilembe Mines Hospital that was halfway immersed in sand and silt.
The UPDF did a very good job in removing the sand which had settled inside the rooms, as well as the sand which had settled all up to here. You can see up such a level, removing the sand which is up to such a level, the whole compound is a very difficult job. But the UPDF helped with that. Thank you, UPDF, for really being our savior.
The Kasese district officials played a major role in carrying out a needs assessment study and identifying the most affected households as well as the most relevant and needed relief items. The government officials sensitized the public on the risks and safety measures. They also solicited relief from both government and non-government bodies and delivered to the affected people. They were charged with the overall coordination and monitoring of the situation. There have also been relief supplies from a number of non-governmental agencies, including the Red Cross, ADRA Uganda, World Vision, Strides for Family Health, UNICEF, Save the Children, and other corporate bodies like Centenary Bank, Stanbic Bank, etc. Also, the Catholic Church and other churches have also trickled in with limited relief items, both food and non-food items. However, there have been a number of challenges registered even when it comes to the distribution of relief items.
Mostly in matters concerning health, we are bad off. Since we are living in the classes of the school, we are compacted there. We are lacking materials that we use, like blankets, mattresses. We are living, we are sleeping on tarpaulins. Like in a class, they can give you two tarpaulins. You put the, you lay them down, then you sleep like a population of like 40 people in a class compacted. And we have found a problem that people are not of the same characters, people are not of the same habits, so other people are badly behaved, and other people, they can't participate in health matters like others they do.
A good number of the locals complained of the unequal and unfair criteria for distribution of the relief items to some people in the camps, as well as within the villages. Whereas it is important to appreciate the efforts of government and other relief agencies, it is worth noting that more gaps still need to be addressed. How is it possible that despite the fact that we seem to know that these calamities will happen, we still cannot prepare enough for them?
So I think there is need for a study to be carried out to establish the actual causes of the floods. Look at the source. Though there is some cultural belief that it occurs every 50 years, like Nyamwamba, that it was behaved like that around 1964, some say 1968. But I believe it's both human factors that cause those floods. Yeah, there is a need for a study, a risk hazard mapping. You make a survey and find out what are the likely risks, what are the sort of hazards in the region. If it is a flood, if it is a disease epidemics, outbreaks, if it is landslides, what causes them and what can the people do in order to prevent the preventive measures? In this business of disaster, we call it the emergency preparedness. You prepare so that you can reduce the risk of an occurrence of a disaster. I think that can do. And as you know, studies take long. But of course, as a university institution, Makerere, we have so many university institutions, you can also go into this. The risk and hazard mapping exercise, and what can be done to reduce the occurrence of the effects of a disaster in case it occurs, or to prevent it. Yeah. Not only disaster reduction, but the disaster prevention.
The Resilient Africa Network, funded by United States Agency for International Development, is a consortium of 20 African universities in 16 countries. It is led by Makerere University with Stanford University, Tulane University, and the Center for Strategic and International Studies as partners.
RAN stands for creating resilience at community level for the people of Africa who have suffered and undergone a lot of stress and shocks from disasters.